Good afternoon and welcome to Sunday Grandstand, the last Sunday before Christmas, and my head is now full of all the things that I should have done. I haven't got around to yet, but if you're sitting at home and doing your wrapping up, then we've got plenty to keep you entertained between now and 5:30. For the first part of the programme, we're based here at Olympia, the place that staged the first ever international show jumping competition in this country. That was back in 1907. In 1972, Raymond Brooks Ward started the Christmas show at Olympia. If you've ever seen it, you'll know what it's all about, because it's more than just show jumping, and see it once, you will never forget it.
To make sure you're connected, the writing's on the wall. But if your mind's neglected, stumble, you might fall, stumble, you might fall.
No, hide.
Stumble, you might fall.
They don't have dressage or dog agility at the snooker to keep the crowds entertained, and with a final like this, they don't need it. Steve Davis is looking for a 17th UK Championship title, 18 years after he won his last. And in that year, his opponent today, Ding Junhui, was barely even born. It is a sensational UK Championship final. It's coming up at 3 o'clock. Let's just take you through all the timings this afternoon. Coming up next, we've got the men's downhill from Val Gardena and the women's downhill from Val d'Isère. That's in Ski Sunday. Then at 1 o'clock, we'll be here at Olympia for the FEI World Cup qualifier. All the top riders are competing in that over fences that go up to 5'3" in height. We'll also be showing you a sensational puissance competition. That'll come at the first interval of the snooker. So after four frames of the UK Championship final, you can see the puissance. That snooker starting at 3 o'clock. Hazel Irvin is in position. And as we said before, Steve Davis against Ding Junhui, a man who's been described as Mozart by Peter Ebdon. Not sure what his composing's like, but he's pretty good on the table. Now, if you're watching BBC Two earlier, you will know that Liverpool conceded their first goal in over 17 hours of competitive football when Sao Paulo scored the only goal of the FIFA Club World Championship. Mineiro's goal after 27 minutes was the difference, although Liverpool were all over them in the second half. They had three goals disallowed, one from Luis Garcia, one from Sami Hupia, one from Sinemap on goal. They also hit the bar, but sadly Liverpool will return from Yokohama in Japan, having lost the FIFA Club World Championship. Sensational match though, and hope you enjoyed it. Well, show jumping to come then, snooker to come as well. The course is being built behind me. The riders are walking it and probably thinking, does it have to be this big? It does, I'm afraid. We're going to concentrate though for the next half an hour or so on skiing. It's time for Ski Sunday.
Welcome to this lunchtime edition of Ski Sunday. This week we're in the picturesque resort of Val Gardena, nestled in the Italian Dolomites and surrounded by the most sensational scenery.
It's an unusual part of the world. The resort splits into three different villages, each with three different names.
Silva,
Salva,
and Wolkenstein.
Oh, in the two languages.
Yeah.
Ortigei,
St. Ulrich,
Ortigei,
Santa Cristina.
Ah, danke.
Bitteschön.
Grazie.
Buon appetito.
And the food is a hearty mixture of Austrian and Italian.
Whilst the skiing offers a seemingly endless terrain of wide open runs and high-speed cruising.
In this week's show, we meet the emerging superstar of Scandinavian skiing, Axel Lund Svindal. He and his rivals will be throwing themselves down the infamous camel bumps in the Saslong downhill. The women will be picking up where the men left off in Val d'Isère. And we'll bring you up to date with the best action from the men's night slalom in Madonna.
Now, last week's downhill was a classic glider's course, but this Val Gardena piece offers a more varied challenge. Here, more racers will be sizing up the piste, knowing they have a real chance of victory.
I came down with the legs burning and sweating, and I like that kind of feeling, you know.
It's looking good for Val Gardena. I've got good gliding abilities, and that really counts.
That's a perfect course. It's very smooth here. It's perfect slope.
I tried to do my best on this course. It's very nice to ski here. It's a great slope, and it's very good conditions now.
The berms, the jump, the gliding part, it's everything. I like it here.
It's really fun to ski on this slope, especially the camel jump is very long and high. It's a crazy jump.
It's good because I'm from old people from Gardena, and I'm here like a home.
Another man increasingly at home on the World Cup circuit is Norway's Axel Lund Svindal. A young all-rounder on the brink of emulating his great compatriots, Lasse Schus and Kjetil André Aarmodt.
Well, I had tons of inspiration because that was basically the first race I can remember looking at television and really know what was going on. That was in the 92 Olympics in Albertville. And since then I would watch Schus and Aarmodt and those guys on television every race. I guess if you ski well, that you pick up points in every race, and then you're there for the overall too. And I don't think too much about it because I just want to try to ski fast in races.
You're the young guy in the Norwegian squad. You have Kjetil Aarmodt, Lasse Schus, the older guys, multi-event skiers. Do they give you guidance within the team, or do you just watch and learn?
It's not like we don't sit down like, okay, let's sit down and we're gonna teach you something. It's more like because we're really good friends and the whole team, we're really close, and like I hang out with these guys in the summer as well. I just watch them and see what they do and kind of, I guess, copy something.
Well, how are you feeling? Because you had a big crash in training yesterday. What happened? Was it on the camel bumps?
Yeah, I caught an edge just 5 meters before the jump, so I couldn't really recover before I went over it, and then basically flew 50 meters and landed on my neck, so I guess I was kind of lucky.
You're a World Cup skier. What's the worst thing and the best thing?
Well, the best thing is, is a lifestyle, I guess, and just that you're able to ski the whole time. This is what I love to do, and I can do it as my living. I can earn money off this, and that's perfect.
You feel like you belong on the World Cup?
Yeah, I do, for sure.
Well, this is what Axel Lund Svindal will have to take on. A course with more jumps than any other, in particular the camels, where you have to jump a minimum of 40 metres. In order to do that, I borrowed Finley Mickle's race suit so that I've got enough speed. Starting to feel a little nervous. Here goes. Okay, no going back now. Here we go. Goggles down and onto the course. Tight left-hander, and you're already on the first jump. It's really rough and bumpy down here. Into the compression, and there's another jump. Big tight turn, and another jump, big flight there. Another little jump. Oh, you should have pushed off that one. Right. A bit wider the line there. Needed to go a bit harder off that. Picked up.
god. Now I know why I quit wearing a suit.
I was so close to going down there. Caught an edge in the chaz that pitched forward. Thought I'm not going to rush to do that again. No way.
Well, Graham is just about okay, although his nerves are somewhat frayed. He arrived in the finish area minus his boot camera, which was later retrieved. Even on a snowy day, the views in this part of the Alps are dramatic, with the craggy peaks of the Sassalungo dominating the skyline. The poor weather has forced the organisers to lower the start and the course to be reset to avoid some of the more dangerous sections. So here we go with the 2005 Sasslung Downhill. Michael Valkofer of Austria on his way, wearing number 9. The current leader is Scott McCartney of the USA, 33.86, and Valkofer is 0.32 quicker.
Well, that's where they've reset the course to avoid the camel jumps. They've taken the racers round to the left-hand side of the jumps where they would normally be jumping a 60-metre route. They've now got to absorb both of the bumps into the chaz lat. This is a really bumpy, difficult section, and that was a good line from Valkofer. Stay tight in on the gate.
The advantage of the Val Gardena course is that the majority of the run is set between the trees, which means that the racers still have good visibility even when it's snowing, and Valkofer is making the most of it. 0.41 up.
Well, Valkofer on that exit to the chaz lat, the big long right hander, he went very, very wide in the line, but did seem to be carrying the speed.
He is such an excellent skier technically, and totally courageous. Just a little twitch as he comes into the finish. The lead should go to Valkofer. The lead does go to the Austrian, 0.89 quicker than McCartney. That's a huge margin.
Well, Valkofer's not sure if it's good enough. Only time will tell. Well, he did run very wide in the line coming out of the chaz lat.
Number 10 for Great Britain. This is Finlay Mickle. Launched a new sponsorship deal with the whole Sub-Tyrol area, this region of Italy, last week, and has been christened Quick Mick by his new management, Italian management. Finlay a second behind at the first intermediate. Ooh, and a little unsure.
A little bit hard, just caught an edge as he went on. Now the turn into the chaz lat, jumps over that little roller. That's a good line. Just standing with the weight slightly on the inside ski now. Another little jump, you have to jump over the rollers. It's really difficult with this bad light to actually pick them out.
Finlay getting thrown about all over the place as he makes his way somewhat tentatively towards the finish. More than a second behind the target time set by Michael Valkofer. That's a decent looking jump by the Scot. The finish line is in sight now for Great Britain's number one. But I'm not sure that that time of Michael Valkofer's will be troubled by Finlay Mickle. In fact, he's seventh. That's a disappointing run compared to what he's achieved so far this season, 1.77 seconds off the pace.
Well, Finlay Lee seemed to lose all his time on the top of the course. He was already a second down on the top section.
On course for Norway, Kjetil Andre Aarmodt knows this course like the back of his hand, has raced here more than anybody else currently competing on the World Cup circuit, possibly apart from Christian Gudina, who's yet to come.
Well, Aarmodt's in touch, only 12 hundredths down on Valkofer, and Aarmodt will see these turns well. Good through the chaz lat. He's already in touch, he's tucking out this section. Just a little wide in that turn. Now this is the turn that Valkofer went wide on. Look how much tighter Aarmodt is.
Full out attack from Kjetil Andre Aarmodt, who's currently third in the World Cup downhill standings behind Fritz Strobel and Michael Valkofer. And that after a year out with injury. What a comeback.
And only 700s down at the intermediate time. He doesn't have the weight and strength of Valkofer for this final shot.
But he's certainly got the technique. Look how low and compact Aarmodt is as he crosses the line. Oh, he's second. 0.57. Just over half a second down. Valkofer first. Now Kjetil Andre Aarmodt into second position.
Tips are really up there as he flew over one of the rollers in the chaz lat. Aarmodt, really aggressive.
Valkofer, relieved. Now next to go, Eric Gay of Canada, second in yesterday's Super G. A sign that the Canadian team, and particularly Eric Gay, are approaching their best form, and he's dead level with Valkofer at the intermediate.
Good through the newly set camel jumps.
jumping needed. It's aggressive, he hit the gate as he comes in through into Chazza, a little bit thrown into the air there, got to pop off that roller, didn't do that particularly well.
Eric Gay, part of a very young but very promising Canadian team who have their sights set on the 2010 Olympic Winter Games to be held in Vancouver with the ski racing on the classic Whistler track.
Gay has picked up time, he's now only 400th down on Valhopper. See that exit turn of the Chazlat very, very well. He's absolutely flying, got good air going off that jump. Shows he's really trucking down here.
The target time belongs to Michael Valhopper. It's 1 minute 28.01 seconds, and Gay's right in there again. Second place, that's where he finished in yesterday's Super G. What a weekend for the young Canadian.
Well, that was superb skiing through the Chazlat. It was a little bit rough going in, but on the exit, really carried the speed.
Marco Buchel from Liechtenstein, number 24. Now, Buchel goes about his business quietly and effectively. He has amazing success considering he's a one-man team. 800th up on Michael Valhopper at the early intermediate time. This is a storming start by Marco Buchel.
Of course, the Liechtenstein team do train with the Swiss. In fact, Liechtenstein has won on this course in the past. It's Marcus Foser, back in the early 90s, won on this course. Buchel, he's a little crazy guy, likes to go base jumping in the summertime. Skied that, Chazlat turned well, and he's, well,
0.29 up now. As far as I remember, Marco Buchel has never won a World Cup downhill. His success has come mainly in giant slalom and Super G, but he could be about to break his duck here in Val Gardena.
Valkov was very, very fast over this last section.
Buchel's going to push him right to the limit here. Buchel is first. Oh, it couldn't be much closer. 0.02 of a second. What a run by Marco Buchel. He is in ecstasy. 26, Bodie Miller. The conditions have just deteriorated slightly for Bodie Miller. He hasn't got quite as good visibility at the top as Buchel had, and he made a big mistake there.
Well, this is the newly set part of the course, and the racers will only have had a course inspection to have a look at it. They haven't had a training run, and obviously it's cost Bodie. He didn't quite get the line right. And not good there either, too much in the air for the jump, that one.
Until yesterday, Bodie Miller was the leader in the World Cup overall standings. He was knocked off top spot after yesterday's Super G by Axel Lundsvindal, and Miller is all over the place.
Now, he's just not timing the rollers. On this Val Gardena course, particularly in Chazlat, you have to jump off some and suck up with your knees some of the others. And that just takes timing. It takes being able to see the snow as well.
The crowd can see Bodie Miller. Plenty of neutrals here have come to support the American. He has a massive fan club. Can he give them something to cheer about today? Well, not really. Fifth place by Miller's standards is disappointing. 3/4 of a second off the pace of Marco Buchel.
Well, that was the Chazlat. Buchel, well, he's still there.
World Cup downhill leader Fritz Strobel had a miserable Super G yesterday. He pushed out of the start gate, and 5 yards into his run, he fell flat on his face. It was quite an extraordinary thing, and highly embarrassing for the Olympic downhill champion. He'll be looking to redress the balance today with a storming run here.
Well, he's going to need to pick it up. He was 0.4 down, and that wasn't too clever either. Need to keep the skis on the snow so you can keep turning and then jump over this roller to clear the backside of the second.
105.6 for Buchel. Fritz Strobel isn't too far away. 106 dead, 4/10 still to five. A minute of the first downhill of the season in Lake Louise, and he backed that up with second position last weekend in Val d'Isère.
It's really fast down here. You're touching 90 miles an hour as you go over these last jumps.
Buchel 127.99, Strobel beyond that. Fourth place only for the Olympic downhill champion. That goes some way to make the amends for yesterday's what happened next moment. Buchel still in there in the leader's enclosure, on the verge of his first downhill win, but Christian Gardena is still to come. Gardena loves this course, and he was quickest in the final training run on Thursday.
Well, he gave an absolute masterclass display of skiing this course. I was with the American team, and they were watching every single moment of his run, every little bump and roller. He skied to absolute absolute perfection, but Gardena doesn't like it when the light gets bad.
So far so good for Christian Gardena. From not too far away, just over the hill in Cortina d'Ampezzo, his fan club have made the journey to watch him race today. 105.6 is what he's chasing. 105.77 is what he's got. This is close. Gardena could do this.
It's only 17 hundredths of a second. He did carry speed very, very well out of the Chaslat, the turny section. He's got to get the shoulders down now, get the head down. You're almost not looking where you're going to try and increase the speed.
Huge crescendo of noise echoes around the mountains now as Christian Gardena comes through for four. Oh, that's a hugely disappointing result for the legion of Gardena fans. Once again, flat light proves to be the Italians' undoing. 32, Axel Lundsvindal of Norway, the new World Cup overall leader. Not a good start, full second down, and conditions are worsening all the time.
Lundsvindal, second down at the top of the course, obviously didn't glide particularly well. Did ski well in yesterday's Super G. Didn't quite get enough pop off that first jump going into the Chaslat to pull his feet up, so he didn't hit the top of the second bump. Oh, that wasn't very clever either. The line was totally wrong, and you can see the skis go sideways, which really cut the speed down.
The important thing for Svindal here is to score World Cup points. He competes in all four disciplines. He's got the overall World Cup for this season in his sights now, and he has to come close to Bodie Miller in every discipline. Those two are the main contenders for the World Cup overall title this year. And Svindal, well, 1.86 down. He's slower than Miller. He's 24. That's not so good.
Bad day in the office for Svindal. Plenty more races to come, though.
And a very good day for Marco Bukel. There'll be plenty of celebrations in Val Gardena tonight. His first World Cup downhill win. Marco Bukel wins in Val Gardena ahead of Michael Valcoffer with Eric Gay of Canada third. Great Britain's Finlay Mickel finished in 25th position. In Monday's night slalom from Madonna, world champion Benny Wright starting number one set a scorching first run pace. Finland's Kalle Palander was next best, while Thomas Grandi of Canada and home favourite Giorgio Rocca filled third and fourth places, respectively. World Cup leader Bodie Miller started well, skiing into fifth place, as did Axel Lundsvindal, who took sixth. More bad news, though, for Great Britain's Alan Baxter. The Scots finished 44th and failed to qualify for the second run. The stage was set for a second run Miller charge, but his inconsistent slalom form came back to haunt him as he straddled the gate. Giorgio Rocca stormed down the course to take the lead. Thomas Grandi couldn't quite catch the Italian, nor could Kalle Palander, leaving just right. The Austrian gave it everything, but couldn't quite overhaul Rocca, giving him his second successive victory.
Over in Val d'Isère, the women have been preparing for their downhill on the OK course, which the men tackled last weekend. So, who's in the running?
Well, Nadia Steger scored her maiden World Cup win in Aspen last week, and Switzerland's first success in 2 years. American Lindsay Kildow is confident after winning the Lake Louise downhill at the start of the season. But they both know their relentless Austrian rivals, led by the former world champions Michaela Dorfmeister and Alexandra Meissnitzer, will be hard to beat.
Well, if you thought the weather was bad in Val Gardena, then take a look at Val d'Isère. Howling gales and driving snow have forced a lowered start on the exposed OK course. After a long delay, the assistant race director has said that the race will go ahead with additional blue dye applied to help the skiers pick out the bumps. In the start gate, wearing number 10, Michaela Dorfmeister, currently second in the World Cup downhill standings. Look at
the conditions she's being forced to race in here. The race starting at the mid station, just next to the Folie Douce restaurant at the top of the bubble. Now she comes down into the meadows.
It's just the wind. The wind is picking up all this new snow. It's swirling it around. You really wouldn't want to ski into a turn and just have a sudden dust devil of snow in front of you and not be able to see. Dorfmeister well down on the top part of the course. 1.25 down on Ceccarelli.
Daniela Ceccarelli, the Italian who currently leads here. This is, incidentally, the third downhill of the season for the women. They race back-to-back downhills at Lake Louise in Canada. Dorfmeister did well. She was second in race one, third in race two, and she's doing well here now. She's 500ths up in Val d'Isère.
She's picked up all of that deficit. She really doesn't look confident at all. Going over the tunnel jump and wide, going through the compression there as well. Wide again, outside ski pulled out into the soft snow at the edge of the track. That's going to slow her down.
106.6 kilometers per hour in very difficult conditions. That's mighty fast for Michaela Dorfmeister, and the lead might well be hers. It is a tenth of a second quicker than Ceccarelli. Mickey Dorfmeister of Austria into first position in Val d'Isère, but the shake of the head says more about the conditions than her run, I think. Number 15, Alexandra Maisnitzer, another one of the veteran Austrians, hugely experienced. Third in race one in Lake Louise, fourth in race two. Currently fifth in the World Cup downhill standings.
We're picking her up lower, much lower down on the course as she comes through the compression. Skied that exit turn much better than Dorfmeister.
And that is reflected in the time. Good speed as well, 110.6 kilometers per hour. And she's got improved visibility at the bottom of the course. Maisnitzer will lead by 0.32. That's a convincing run from Alexandra Maisnitzer. Austria now in first and second position. Dorfmeister will be ejected from the leaders' enclosure to make way for teammate Maisnitzer. Next to go from the United States of America, Lindsay Kildow. Ooh, Kildow in a spot of bother as we pick her up further down the course, chasing that time of Maisnitzer, and despite the mistake, she's ahead.
Yeah, she just caught an edge as she came out of that S coming into the forest, but she does look like she's really attacking. Look at her holding the tuck position, pushing the hands forward, really, really aggressive skiing, tucking all the way through there. This is far, far better skiing than the American girl. Now the intermediate time.
Half a second up, 110.2 through the gun. The World Cup downhill leader, Lindsay Kildow, the winner of the second race in Lake Louise, leads the way in Val d'Isère, 121.91, nearly 0.4 quicker than Maisnitzer. That's a great run from Kildow, having her best season to date so far.
Well, there was just that one slight edge catch as she came into the forest, but other than that, a very strong, aggressive run.
Caroline Lalive in the start gate, number 24. The wind once again swirling around at the top of the course. Now, Lalive had a massive crash in Aspen last weekend. You may have seen that on Ski Sunday. In a Super G, she piled into a control gate and was lucky to ski away unscathed. That was symptomatic of the way she really attacks all these courses. And more often than not, she does crash. You think that if she gets it right and the luck is on her side, she will be a threat. Oh, she's fast here, 107.4, 0.41 down.
Well, it hasn't lessened her aggression. She really tucked into the compression there, really attacking.
And it's USA 1 and 2, Kildow first, Lalive second. The best run we've seen for ages from Caroline Lalive from Steamboat Springs. Number 27. From Germany, wearing the familiar tiger stripe suit. This is Petra Hartmeier.
Well, Petra's had some real problems on the German team. Almost kicked off the team a couple of years ago. Really needs to get a good performance this season if she wants to go to the Olympic Games in Turin.
Can we pass the AAA restaurant up through the knee-squashing compression and down into the forest? Almost there now on this very short course.
That was good skiing coming out of the compression. That's in touch.
109 kilometers per hour, fast skiing from Petra Hauptmeier. And a little bit of blue sky to guide the way as she crosses the line into four. Just over half a second off the pace. Improving form this season from Petra Hauptmeier. She really is staking a claim for Olympic selection. One and two, USA, Kildow on the right, Lalive on the left. In the start, Janica Kostelic, number 30. Away she goes, huge, powerful start from Kostelic.
Well, Kostelic's downhill form hasn't been good at the start of this season. She just doesn't look confident. And a big skid going onto the tunnel jump there, really put the skis sideways. Doesn't look to be attacking. She's been skiing well in slalom and giant slalom. Doesn't have the same form as she did in downhill as last season.
Well, with all the injuries and the big crashes she's had over the years, it's no surprise that she's just being slightly cautious in the speed event. She wants to stay healthy for the main event of the season, where she'll be defending three titles, of course, the Olympic Winter Games. 0.81, she's not too far behind the Americans. Possibilities of a top five finish here for Janica Kostelic, and fifth place it is. 1:22.48, the clock hasn't stopped on your screens, but I can see from the computer that the Croatian is in the top five. Kildow beginning to celebrate now, about to reinforce her hold on the World Cup downhill standings. Shemi Alcott for Great Britain. She stumbled with her ski pole. She's got to watch that. She had a dodgy start last weekend in the Aspen Super G. She's away cleanly this time. 49.19, within a second of the lead. Respectable skiing so far from Shemi Alcott.
There's good turns on the top section. She's really pushing the shoulders down. Hit the gate there. It's aggressive skiing. Now the compression. This is where you need to carry the speed out onto the small flat.
Oh, she's almost gone. Big upper body twist. Good recovery from Alcott. She'll be happy to finish in one piece after that moment. But look at the time difference now. The mistakes have taken their toll.
Yeah, really did slip away. That wasn't the spot to make that mistake.
Now, can Shemi get in the points? Well, she's in the World Cup points for the moment. 28, but more than 2 seconds off the pace of Lindsay Kildow of the United States, who takes the Val d'Isère downhill. It's a US 1-2 with Caroline Lalive in second. Confirmation of the results. The second downhill victory of the season for Lindsay Kildow, with Caroline Lalive second and Alex Meissnitzer third. Great Britain's Shemi Alcott finished out of the points in 32nd, and despite Nadia Steger's promising start to the season, she failed to finish.
Hey there, if you want to win these Supercross skis signed by Herman Meyer and myself, log in the Ski Sunday website and answer the following question. Who was crowned the Olympic downhill champion 30 years ago at the 1976 Innsbruck Games? Was it A, Jean-Claude Keely, B, Bernard Roussy, or C, Franz Klammer? If you think you know the answer, call the number below and log on to Ski Sunday website. Good luck.
Well, that's it for this week, but we'll be back in the new year with a special run of Winter Olympics Ski Sundays.
Claire Balding will be showing us around the Olympic sites in Turin, and we'll have our usual feast of alpine skiing from Adelboden, Bormio and Maribor. So all that remains to be said is
Happy Christmas and a very merry new year.
Joyeux Noël.
Fröhliche Weihnachten.
Feierabend, gute jule gott nytt år.
Vám gleichem želím veselý Božič.
Buon Natale a tutti.
Merry Christmas.
Just so envious now of Matt and Graham, and just the way they can ski and how beautiful it looks out there. I was out in Turin, and you'll see the sights and sounds of Turin early next year. It's 54 days exactly until the opening ceremony of the Winter Olympics, which will take place half in Turin and half up in the mountains in Sestriere. You'll see it all on the BBC. And if you were watching the BBC earlier, you'll have seen Liverpool narrowly losing the Club World Championship final. They were desperately unlucky, had three goals disallowed, Sao Paulo beating them 1-0. Highlight of this afternoon's Premiership action Arsenal against Chelsea. That's a 4 o'clock kickoff. We're here at Olympia. They've done the dramatic music. They're now just explaining to the crowd about the class that we're going to show you live, which is the World Cup qualifier. There are 13 legs for qualification for the World Cup final, which this year takes place in Kuala Lumpur. Well, next year, actually, next April. Now, only a certain number of riders can qualify. So they go through all these qualifying sections, just like England trying to qualify for the Football World Cup. They earn points, and those with the highest number of points go through to the final. Now, only two British riders have ever won the World Cup. John Whisker did it twice on Milton, and Nick Skelton did it back in 1995 on Dollar Girl. He is part of a stellar lineup for today's class. 37 riders in total, and here are some of the top ones to watch out for. We've got the world number one from Germany, Marcus Enning, a beautiful rider. All the other riders admire his style. Also in there, Robert Smith, who's won this class twice, and Nick Skelton on board his stallion Arco, having a fantastic year with him. And he's a big, powerful horse, can really pick up off the ground. He was desperately disappointed with him in Athens, but today he should do really well. Ellen Whitaker, 19 years old, very much the future of British show jumping, another one from the Whitaker clan. And Ben Mayer, who you saw winning the Hickstead Derby and the Hickstead Speed Derby, he's in there as well. Well, this is the sixth of 13 legs, so let's have a look at the World Cup standings so far. And these legs take place all over the world, so naturally those that have already happened in America or in Australia or wherever favour certain riders. At the top is Gerco Schroeder of the Netherlands. Beat Mandley. He'll be last to go in today's class. He is currently in second place. Actually, Marcus Beerbaum's last to go, but Beat Mandley competing today. Nick Skelton currently in third place, having a very good season on Arco. And Marcus Enning, the world number one, we mentioned him, he's currently lying in fourth place. Well, the course is built, the riders have walked it. There are 13 jumps, 16 jumping efforts in total, a treble and a double, a maximum height of 5'3". You can see in these indoor arenas, particularly here at Olympia, how close the crowd are. Now, some horses can cope with that. Some find it all a little bit too much and have cotton wool stuffed down their ears so that they don't have to hear so much of it. But it's a great experience for the audience, and for the riders, they have to keep their cool even more than usual. I don't think that horse is competing, although he wouldn't be bothered by the atmosphere. It's very tight as well in this indoor arena, so you need a horse that's really nimble. Well, let's find out what Stephen Hadley and Mike Tucker make of this lineup. It's multinational, and it's pretty high class, isn't it, Mike?
Yes, Claire, it certainly is. Olympia always attracts the best, but I think this year, not only has it attracted the top names, but a lot of combinations that are absolutely on fire, including, I'm delighted to say, as you suggest, some of our British riders. In all over the years, Britain's got a pretty good record. They have won the qualifier here at Olympia on 11 occasions, but it's also been some big winners. But funnily enough, Marcus Enning, that you mentioned, the world's number one, has never won the World Cup qualifier in this arena. He's 5-1, but it's Nick Skelton who's 4-1 favourite on Arco. Been saved for this class. And the first one we're going to see is a young lady from Denmark, Linnea Eriksson, riding her own and Fiji Swadley's Piero's Zed Hillock. Third in the World Cup qualifier at Helsinki. Fairly inexperienced at this level. The course built by the very talented Brazilian man, Guilhem George. Built a brilliant track last night in here to give us a fantastic class, and we're looking forward to this World Cup qualifier now, Steve.
Certainly, Mike, and I hope this is as good as last night's, because I think that was as good as I've ever seen. The standard of jumping at Olympia this week has just been out of this world. There's so much content in this course that you can't talk about it all with one rider. We're going to have to look at it in detail as we get down the field. But suffice to say, it's big. You need a real big jumper, a real careful horse. Control is everything. There's a lot of distance problems. The poles are so light. I mean, that horse had the slightest rub there, and the pole has gone. Modern show jumping is all about light poles, shallow cups, careful horses with a huge jump. If you haven't got one of those this afternoon, you might as well be at a local show at home, because you won't win here. A line here. Fairly straightforward distance down the centre of the line. It's 155, 160 all the way around, full-blown World Cup qualifier. Guy, the course builder from Brazil, he's looking for about 8 or 9 clears. and a fascinating jump-off competition as well, jump-off course rather, but we'll come to that later. I mean, that horse has jumped a fairly reasonable round and had four down.
Yeah, time incidentally 68.87, her time, time allowed for the course 71 seconds. So I wouldn't think time allowed should play too much of a part in this first round unless perhaps there is a refusal. Big field, I think as big a field as we've had in this. And in comes here Louise Ofrecht, one of the up-and-coming German lady riders, trains with Kurt Grabemeyer, the national trainer and indeed the manager of the German team. Great trainer these days. And she's riding Hofgut Lidermax Abriska. This an ex-ride actually of Michael Whittaker. And she was fifth in a good Grand Prix recently down in the indoor show in Munich. She's actually competed 11 times for Germany in one of their team competitions. Haven't seen her here before, but she is quite experienced. Not a lot of form, though, in the World Cup at the moment.
Distance problems straight away here around this this fence here. Six or seven, she chose to go the seven round the outside route, round the scenic route as the riders say, kept in the left hand side of the fence, opened the corner, went the long way. That little stile around the corner at fence four is enormous. It's 160, which, you know, okay, is a normal Grand Prix fence, but it is so narrow and there's just three little poles. You need a real jumper to get that out of the way. Six or seven round the corner here again to a big tall oxer, not very wide. He's been fairly easy on him down the middle here. One stride double, four strides to a big wide oxer and three long ones, 17 and a half yards, which he's going to get horses to just go forward to get the 17 and a half. It's a bit of a long distance and you can trail a fence off behind like she did. Again, six or seven round the corner and a very short four to the Oxford finish.
12 volts for Pierre-Louise. Pierre-Louise, whose best placings have been on the Scandinavian World Cup circuit. They start at the beginning. She was placed in Oslo in Norway. But a name I think we will hear more of. The ladies in Europe playing a bigger and bigger part, mainly thanks to Meredith Michaels Baerbaum, who has, of course, been top of the world rankings and really is challenging the best of the men in the world, and the ladies are following her too. Full house, electric atmosphere in this grand hall, and one of the great assets of having this World Cup qualifier, it's allowing British spectators, young British riders, to watch the world very best riders at work, and that has to be a huge advantage, and the standard, believe me, is very high. And one has to say, Steve, that the footing here is playing a very good part. We might talk a bit more about that in a moment. It's Sebastian Numanen now from Finland with sails away. He's been here before. Sadly, he's got one horse that's actually a little sick at the moment, but this is a very good horse and has actually been placed two on the Scandinavian circuit of these World Cup qualifiers.
Yeah, well, you know, talking about the underfoot conditions, I mean, these horses really jump off these springy artificial surfaces. I had dinner with Bob Ellis and Guy, the course builder, last night, and we talked about this at length, and they said that you have to build, he said he was going to have to build very big this afternoon because he doesn't want double figures of clears. He said horses jump out of their skins for this particular class because riders save them, like Nick Skelton, only jumped one small class this week and out he comes straight into the World Cup. Keep them fresh. And a normal, big, difficult course is very often not quite enough.
So far, and I think we will see a
a number of clear irons when we really do get to the top names in the competition. Well, a strong British contingent. The next in is William Funnell, riding Denise Stamps, Cordofex Amber du Mantois, and Will is very aware of the very high class field and competition he has this afternoon.
I think it'll be tough. You know, we've got, I think, seven Germans here, and they're always very strong, you know, and campaign hard for these World Cups. I mean, you know, hopefully Nick Skelton's been going very well with Arco, so I think most people would have to put him sort of right up at the top of the bookies ladder, really.
Well, Steve, Will got Mondrian in hospital, sadly, and so Amber du Mantois, his ride this afternoon, but things have not gone right for Will ever since the show started.
No, you know, I mean, Mondrian, he had a long, hard season, as Will said yesterday, and I said on the air, but he had an attack of colic yesterday. He's okay, I believe, but, you know, he's certainly not going to jump again this year, this show. So Will got to rely on Amber this afternoon, had a mistake and a stop, so it's academic now. I mean, I'd rather question whether he'll bother to carry on around the rest of the course. Yeah, I thought he would probably wisely pull up when he got down the other end there. He jumped a few fences, got them there, back on song again. Give her a pat, it'll be another day for her. You have to be philosophical in this job. You're not going to win them all at this level. Not by a long, long way.
No, there's always another day. Certainly a very high-class mare. A mare that actually has been ridden by Peter Charles, John Whittaker, but I think has gone as well for Will as anyone. Well, now back inside to Belgium's Maurice van Roosbrock. 13-year-old, owned by Frans Lettens and by the very good Stallion Lord, Le Coupe C. Maurice van Roosbrock, one of a very strong national bunch of riders in Belgium. They've got a very good record. In fact, he's known all over mainland Europe. Belgium, who these days have got as strong a squad as many. They really have come back right into the reckoning. And Ludo Philippart, probably a man who's won here in the past, one of the reasons why the selection for the team has been so competitive.
You see, he's chosen to go the short route. He jumped that fence, the second fence, right in the right-hand corner and went straight across the corner and got the six. Actually finished up there a little bit deep, which stopped the horse going forward, and he had the back rail instead. Not a lot of assistance from the horse at that one, I feel. Ooh, now he could be in trouble. Big scopy horse, got away with it. Went very high at the first part. Nice distance round the corner to that oxer. To have a horse that's helping you every inch of the way here this afternoon, and he's decided that that's enough.